We invite you to stand with us as we open singing glory to his name.
Down at the cross where my Savior died, down where for cleansing from sin I cried, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. So sweetly abides within. There at the cross where he took me in. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to me and keeps me clean. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name.
You may be seated. Good morning, everyone. It is great to see you guys. We got some great weather here. I just wanted to say a welcome to everyone. My name is Lindsay. I'm the Children's Ministry Director here. And if this is your first time with us, we're especially glad to see you. And we would love for you to take out this communication card. You can find it in your bulletin. I'll show you how to do it. And you can fill it out and just put it, thank you. Been practicing all day. You can just put that in the offering plate, and we would love to follow up with you, maybe see what brought you here, if there's anything we can do for you. And one thing I just wanted to share, something that I love about this church is I love the team that I serve with in children's ministry. Not only do I get to do something that I really enjoy, but I've really connected with the team, and we've become good friends, and they're supportive, and we can pray for one another. So I would really encourage you, if you have not found a place to plug in and get involved, that you would think about that, because not only do you get to do something that you like, and you get to serve the kingdom, but you also have a really good team that can surround you and support you and kind of build a network there. So thanks so much, and back to Lisa.
Thank you, Lindsay. When we get back into worship this morning, I just was thinking as we were preparing the music this week, we typically do the same thing. We get in here, we sing an upbeat song, and that's great. We get us all ready for the Lord, and then we get into the worship. But as I was preparing, I thought, you know, this is Communion Sunday, and are our hearts ready to come before the throne of God? And so this morning, we're going to be singing some songs that are familiar to most of you, but I want you to think about the words. Sometimes we sing the same song over and over again. Do you really know what you're singing? So I want you to focus on those words. Last week, we sang a song, This is Amazing Grace, and this week, we're going to sing Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. Let's stand together as we worship. Think about the sacrifice Jesus made for you as you sing this song.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Precious.
My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy
be a reminder to you today that His grace is unending. His mercies are new every morning.
The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secure.
Best part
will be forever mine.
take out your bulletin. And I don't want you to open it. I just want you to look at the front cover. If you don't have one, I'll read it to you. The Lord is working. He is working in His church. He is working in His people. And when we prepare worship services, we don't know what the bulletin's going to say. That's something that our secretary puts together. But when I looked at this yesterday, I thought, we're going to be singing a song entitled Cleanse Me. And the first verse is this scripture right here. Let's look at this. It says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and lead me in the way everlasting." Psalm 139, 23 through 24. And it's such a fitting song to sing before we come to this communion table. That's what we need to do. We need to be in God's presence this morning, searching our hearts. We want to have the Lord bring to us thoughts that we shouldn't have had. So as we sing this song, sing these words as a prayer. Sing this third verse. I want you all just to take a seat. This is a very prayerful song, and yes, we stand to worship, but as we sing this last verse, it says, "Lord, take my life, make it wholly thine." We're here to surrender our pride. We're here to surrender our own objectives, and we're here to give them to the Lord. So if you choose to sing with us, feel free. If you want to close your eyes and just listen to the words and make them a prayer of your heart, feel free to do that. Let's sing this together. Let's pray this together.
Lord, take my life and make it wholly thine. Fill my poor heart with thy great love divine.
Thank you, worship team, for leading us in those songs of praise and worship. It's wonderful to come to East Lake Road Alliance Church this first Sunday in September 2015 and just bring praise to the risen Savior. That's what we do, of course, every time we gather together. But those songs reminded us of what the Lord has done for us, what he's doing for us, and, of course, some of our responsibilities. So I trust that you take them to heart this morning. Will you join your hearts with mine as we seek the Lord together in prayer? Precious Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this opportunity to come together in this place and just to lift Jesus, to magnify his name, and to ask you to be very real to us today. We pray, Lord God, that as we continue to worship through praying and giving and preaching and singing, that we would each one of us be drawn close to you and that you would meet us, Lord God, right at our point of need. We would pray if there be one person in this room today who does not know you as Savior and Lord of their life, that today they would literally pass from death to life and come into a right relationship with Jesus, believing on him for forgiveness of sin, repenting of that sin, and believing on him for eternal life. We pray for that one who may have come in brokenhearted today or just bothered by something, that today, Lord God, you would minister to them, that one who might need a physical touch in their body, that this day, Lord God, you might do that miracle in their body. We just want to thank you for being a God that we can come to, bringing all of our requests and needs to, knowing full well that you are more than capable of answering our prayers exceedingly and abundantly beyond what we can think or imagine. We thank you for the fellowship of believers and the fellowship of the Spirit, and as we bask in the warmth of that, we pray for those of our congregation who are traveling and those, Lord God, who are ill in hospitals and shut-ins, especially, Lord God, our elderly, we would once again lift them to you. Many of them, Lord God, the deepest desire of their heart is to be in this place this day. We'd ask you to be very real to them right where they're at, a tangible presence that they might sense your love and your power in that place. Lord, we ask you to bless our time together. Again, change us by your presence. Mold us more into the image of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. May each one of us go away from this place different than the way we came in. May each one of us have a new song of praise in our heart, on our lips, for what Christ has done for us in this place at this time. We love you, Lord, and we pray all of these things in your mighty and matchless name, the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, our Sanctifier, our Healer, and our soon coming King. We love you, Jesus, and all God's people said, amen, amen, and amen. We're going to ask those who are going to collect the morning tithes and offerings to come forward now. And I want to remind you, if you're visiting with us today, that it's the first Sunday of the month. It's Communion Sunday, traditional Communion Sunday in our church, and we take two offerings on Communion Sunday. The first offering is our regular tithe and offering used to run the expenses of the church. The second one is taken by our deacon board, and it's used by them to help people both inside and outside the church with material needs. So you give as the Lord lays on your heart. Now, I want to give one or two an opportunity to give a verbal tithe of praise before we take the material tithes of praise. Would somebody like to give a verbal tithe of praise this morning? Yes, Cheryl.
I'd like to thank God for his amazing grace to save me. But I want to share with you a phone call I had with my mom last night. She had been praying for a friend of hers that God would open up an opportunity for her to share the gospel. And that when that opportunity came, she was kind of quick to say. And yesterday, this 90-year-old man, he went to
Yeah, yes, all right. Come on. Whoa, praise God, amen. Wow. Wow, praise God. Yeah, a little insignificant event, right? God ordered it for His glory. Praise God, amen. I'll just give a word of thanks for life. The Women's Care Center's dinner's coming up, I think it's next week, and we've been thinking about that and life, and I just thank God for life. And the flowers on the altar are in memory of a life of Allison Marie Sharon, who went to be with the Lord 13 years ago. August 31st. So we just thank God that one day we're going to celebrate with her in heaven. 13 years gone from us now, but living eternally there. And for that, we give thanks. Archie, would you ask a blessing on the offering?
Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, ladies. Amen. Praise God. It's good to know. Amen. Thank you. All right, kids, you want to go to junior church? All right. Some do. Some are thinking about it, and others are on their way. Now, listen, I thank Lindsay for her enthusiastic welcome this morning, but it reminded me that, you know, we have two paid positions that are posted on the bulletin board back there. One is church secretary, the other is Christian ministry, children's ministry assistant. If you are interested in either one of those paid positions or you know somebody who might be, I encourage you to get that description down and pass it around to your friends. We're going to be moving on those two positions as quickly as we can. So if you're interested, please get the word out, okay? Also, I was reminded of a couple of things this morning. On September 13th, we're going to have this report on the Israel trip and the bulletin insert and a lot of stuff going on in September and October at East Lake Road Alliance Church. Pay close attention, but that's coming up. That's next Sunday, I think, right here. And there's a picture of John Baker himself on a camel there. And maybe he'll autograph that for you on your way out if you come to the thing. Anyway, you want to be a part of that. I was also reminded, now get this, I was reminded for you Young at Heart folks, the Tuesday's Young at Heart, and you're to bring an older picture of yourself. No. Right, you're supposed to bring an older, younger picture of yourself, okay? The picture is old, but you were younger, okay? Now one day, maybe when we're in heaven, we'll have older pictures of ourselves. I don't know, but that's Tuesday, and you want to come to that good time planned by all as you look at those younger pictures and try to figure out who in the world was that, you know? Okay, all that being said, in Sunday school, we're doing a First Samuel. If you're not part of our Sunday school program, adult Sunday school classes, I'd encourage you to come to that. It's really a great time. As we look at these accounts of the Old Testament, it's really like holding a mirror up to ourselves. You know, we think that all that stuff we don't relate to that kind of thing. It really does. It's like holding a mirror up to ourselves. And, man, we see all the bad things that people did in those days, and we realize, wow, they're just like me. Well, maybe not like you, but they're a lot like me, amen. And we can learn a lot from it. So I encourage you to come. That's what we're doing today. We're going to continue today looking at this passage of Scripture that we began looking at 4 weeks ago. And I want to thank those men who filled the pulpit for me. Dave Volker did such a wonderful job, and he's teaching on Wednesday nights now, our Bible study. I'd encourage you to come out and try that out. Ben Baker for the wonderful challenge he gave us. And then, of course, last week, Randy Elliott with another powerful challenge. So we thank those men for bringing those messages to us from those passages of Scripture. Today we're going to go back to one that we already been looking at for a while. It's Genesis chapter 11, beginning in verse 27. I want to refresh your memory. We're going to have to read it again and then get right back into it. Genesis chapter 11 begins this way, verse 27. This is the account of Terah. Terah became the father of Abram, Nahor, and Haran. Haran became the father of Lot. While his father Terah was still alive, Haran died in Ur of the Chaldees in the land of his birth. Abram and Noah both married. The name of Abram's wife was Sarai, and the name of Nahor's wife was Milcah. She was the daughter of Haran, the father of both Milcah and Ishka. Now, Sarai was barren. She had no children. Terah took his son Abram, his grandson Lot, son of Haran, and his daughter-in-law Sarai, the wife of his son Abram, and together they set out from Ur of the Chaldeans to go to Canaan. But when they came to Haran, they settled there. Terah lived 205 years, and he died in Haran. The Lord had said to Abram, "Leave your country, your people, and your father's household, and go to the land I will show you." And then he gives him these wonderful promises, and we're going to spend a lot of time on these a little later in the sermon. "I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, And whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. So Abram left as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. Precious Jesus, how we thank you for the Word of God, the complete revealed Word of God, all of it, Genesis to Revelation. We thank you for this passage of Scripture that teaches us so much, Lord God, about a walk of faith. And I pray that once again you would hide this poor preacher behind the very Word of God and the cross of Christ, and by your Spirit's presence and your Word, you would speak to our hearts. Pray this all to your glory, Jesus. Pray it all with much thanksgiving. Amen. Okay, so those of you who have been around, you know, several weeks ago we began looking into this passage regarding a walk of faith. And we began comparing Abraham's call and his walk to the call of everyone who would follow Jesus Christ by faith in obedience. Now, we found out early on that we are all called from the same place as Abraham was called from. The setting of our lives before Christ is the same as Abram's was. It's a setting of judgment, it's a setting of hopelessness, and it's a setting of worldliness. We all come from the same place. We also found out that like Abraham, in verse 12:1, we are called to depart. Remember I told you the King James Version says, get thee out. I like that better. I can see God saying to Abram, get thee out of there. Just like he says to us, get thee out. The call is the same. He told Abram to get out of his country, to get away from his people, his father's household. And you and I, like Abram, are called to sever ties with our past life. It's an important part of walking with the Lord in obedience. We also found out that Abraham, like us, or Abram, I interchange the names, he got tripped up in this area because he did not leave Haran until the death of his father, Terah. And we spent a lot of time looking at that in our last sermon, that you and I, like Abraham, can have Terahs that hold us back from completely following the Lord in 100% obedience in our lives. Now, unfortunately, a lot of times that can be a family member or families. You know, for me, it was my family because I came out of a religion that I was raised in that wasn't the truth. It simply was not the truth. So my family held me back for a while. That could be your case. Families can hold us back. You know, kids coming back today, the bounce backs, the kids that go out and then they come back into the house and they bring all that junk with them, can hold us back from being 100% faithful to God. Material blessings can hold us back. Religion itself can hold us back. Terror was holding him back from following the Lord. We want to make sure there's no terrors in our life that are holding us back from following the Lord. But just as importantly as that, and this is what we wrapped up last time, is that we got to be careful, you and I, as believers in Jesus Christ, who claim Christ as our personal Savior and Lord, that we are not terrors in somebody else's life. This is where we got to be very, very careful. Now, Jesus had something to say about this in Luke chapter 17, verses 1 through 4. Jesus said to his disciples, things that cause people to sin are bound to come. We know that. We live in a sin-sick world and a sin-sick society. These things are bound to come. But woe to the person through whom they come. In other words, you don't want to be a terror in somebody's life and bring that sin into their life. It would be better for that person to be thrown into the sea with a millstone tied around their neck for them to cause one of these little ones to sin. Jesus is saying, woe to the person who brings sin into the life of another person, or especially a disciple of Jesus. This is really a powerful, powerful point that Jesus is making, critical for us who are parents not to bring sin into our children's life. If we call ourselves Christians, let's let our children and our grandchildren see us living as Christians, that kind of thing. You know what I'm saying? So we don't want to be a terror to somebody, okay? But then also, Jesus says this, and I just added this because it really struck me when I was studying for this a couple of weeks ago. Because we talk about we have to be a forgiving people. Forgive as the Lord forgives. And we hear that a lot, you know, forgive, forgive, forgive. And we've got to this place where we not only have easy believism, we have easy forgiveism. And that's not what Jesus says in this passage. He says, if your brother sins, rebuke him. Rebuke him. And if he asks you to forgive him, forgive him. That's not what it says. If he repents, forgive him. And it's another place where we get tripped up in the church today, because we get tripped up on easy believism. We get tripped up on easy forgivism, like God's going to forgive everything without repentance. That's not what Jesus says. He says if he sins against you seven times in a day and seven times comes back to you and says, forgive me, please, forgive him. No, I repent, please forgive him. Now, the grace of God is magnified in this, because Jesus knows us and he knows we're sinful by nature and that we sin a lot. But he says, guess what? If you come to me and say, I repent, even if it's 100 times or 1,000,000 times a day, I repent, he's going to forgive us. That's the good news. Again, I'm not talking about an easy believism or an easy forgivism. I'm talking about true repentance. Jesus expects us to repent, not only to ask for forgiveness, but to repent. Repent means to go in a new direction. I just wanted to bring that out, because so much of the time we hear, oh, we got to forgive, forgive, forgive. We have to forgive when a person seeks to be repentant, okay? Now, we notice this, that after all this time, this delay, this delay was costly to Abraham. And delays are always costly. If we're going to delay following what the Lord has for us, it's always costly. The only thing I've ever heard anybody say in regret after the fact that they came to accept Jesus Christ as their personal Savior is, I wish I would have done it sooner. I wish I would have walked with the Lord sooner. I would have had a bigger impact on my children. I would have had a bigger impact on the world around me. See what I'm saying? It's costly. Abraham's delay was costly. While he lingered there in Haran, precious years passed him by. Those years could have been spent enjoying the best God had to offer. Instead, they were spent watching the father he loved waste away. They were spent being grieved by the sins of a family still in the grip of idolatry. And I would say to you, dear hearts, that the work of the Lord and the time that we have to do it is too short for you and I to hesitate carrying out the orders we receive from him. Why would we settle for second best while wasted years pile up in our lives? Now, we're all guilty of this, myself included, because we lose a sense of urgency to do what God has called us to do because we're lulled to sleep by the world around us. Heaven forbid. We need to be aware of the fact that our time, every one of us, our days are numbered. We only have so much time to have an impact on this world for the kingdom. We need to have an urgency about things. That's what Paul said in Romans chapter 13. I didn't put this one up on the screen for you, but I'm going to read it to you. Romans chapter 13, beginning in verse 11. The Apostle Paul's writing the book of Romans, and you can almost sense the pastoral heart beating in the man as he writes this. He says, do this, understanding the present time. The hour has come for you to wake up from your slumber. He's talking to believers here. The time has come to wake up, because our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. The night is nearly over. The day is almost here. So let us put aside the deeds of the darkness. And he goes on to describe some of those things. Paul is saying, just like God was saying to Abraham, get thee out. Wake up. Wake up. The time is short. Let's be about the Lord's business now, while we can. At the age of 75, anyway, the guy at the age of 75, Abram finally comes to his senses. He makes a break with the old life. He leaves out from Haran on a great adventure of faith. And dear hearts, that's what life in Christ is. It is a great adventure of faith. I mean, it's not all rosy and beautiful and smooth and easy, but it is a great adventure of faith. And listen, we know the end from the beginning. So we can rest in the fact that no matter what we're going through, things are going to get better. We don't have to bring older pictures of ourselves, because we're going to have a better picture of ourselves. Amen. In verse 12:1, we see some of the benefits now that Abraham finally, because he's going to be obedient, is reaping. He walks, he's going to walk in the presence of God. In 12:1, Abram has been called out of the gross darkness of sin to walk in the presence of the Lord. And this verse implies that God intends to lead Abram in the way he should go. I love it because it implies that God himself is going to direct Abraham's pathway. He says, go to the land I will show you. Now, Abram is not going there because God said, go there because I have other people there and they'll tell you how wonderful the place is. You know, he's not going there because his friends told him what a wonderful place it is. He's going there because God told him to go, and God is going to show him. God is going with him. He's going strictly now on faith to a place that God alone is going to show him. And let me say this to you, dear hearts, there is nothing in this world more precious than walking with God by faith. Because the walk of faith puts us in a place of dependence on the Lord, and we know according to his word, he will not let us down. That's what the writer of Hebrews said in Hebrews 13:5. He says this, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. Keep yourselves free from the love of the world and be content with what you have. Why? Because there's a better place ahead, and I'm not going to leave you, and I'm not going to forsake you. That's a wonderful promise. And those people who have learned to solidly lean upon the Lord never need to fear that they're going to leave him or let them down or desert them. God will never do that based on his word. He will never do it. Praise God. They never need to fear that God will fail them as they lean their weight upon him. The psalmist put it this way in Psalm 37:18-19. He said, the days of the blameless are known to the Lord. Now, we know that be blameless in the sight of the Lord, we have to be covered by the blood of the Lamb. There's only one way to be blameless in the sight of God. That is to be cleansed by the blood of his son, Jesus. But look what he says there. Look what he says. And Abram knew this. Their inheritance will endure forever. Now, those of you who have your 401ks and your 403bs in the stock market, notice this week that they can quickly, or the past couple of weeks, erode. They went downhill, by the way, the past couple of weeks. But God's word says that when I have my 401k and my 403b in the kingdom, it's going to endure forever. See, it doesn't matter what happens in China to my inheritance. It doesn't matter what happens to the price of a barrel of oil. My inheritance is secure in Christ Jesus. It's going to endure forever. Look at this, times of disaster. It will not wither away. In times of famine, those who trust the Lord will enjoy it forever. I wonder how Abram, when he finally got this word from God, get thee out, and went, and God was leading him, how his heart must have yearned within him to see what God had in mind for him. Can you imagine how his heart must have yearned? And when I thought of this, I thought of one of my favorite passages of scriptures, Job chapter 19. You know, when we think of Abraham and Job and some of these examples we have of faithful living in the Bible, we think these are like the superheroes of the faith and that nothing ever bad happened to them and, you know, that they didn't have any angst, any problems, anything like that. Can you imagine what Abraham must have thought about as even though he knew the Lord was leading him, left his family, left the society he knew, left his home, everything he knew to follow God? Had to be painful for him. You think of Job. Job, how about Job, the pain that Job suffered physically, psychologically? How about his wonderful wife and the support she gave him? Why don't you just curse God and die? Yet he said this, in the midst of the pain, psychologically and physically, he said this, one of my favorite passages of Scripture, I know that my Redeemer lives. Now he knew the end from the beginning. And then in the end, he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin is being destroyed, even as it was being destroyed, he said this, yet in my flesh I will see God. See, he knew his older picture was going to look better than his younger picture. You didn't know I was going to use this for a message, Therese, did you? He said, I myself will see him with my own eyes, I and not another. Look how my heart yearns within me. His heart yearned for the inheritance that he had in his Savior. Abram's heart must have yearned. Does our heart yearn in us for what is ahead of us? Or are we always looking back and worried about what we got now? Do you see what I'm saying? He got to walk in the presence of God, and then he got to think about the providence of God. Now, this is what I want to spend the rest of our time with. I want to talk about this a little bit, because he got to watch God's providence. God makes some wonderful promises to Abram in these verses, and I want you to look at all the things God promises to this great man. I want you to know first of all, that in those there are seven promises in that blessing, in that what we call the Abrahamic covenant. There are seven promises. Now, seven in the Bible speaks of completeness. It speaks of wholeness. It speaks of something being altogether there. And it speaks to our hearts today is the fact that in Christ alone, in the promises of God, do you and I find fulfillment and completeness. Without it, we have no completeness. But in the promises of God, we are made complete and we are made whole. God promises them these things. Look at this. Count them with me. To make them into a great nation. He says, I will bless you. Your name will be great. You will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you. I will curse those who curse you. And all people will be blessed through you. Seven. Complete. Now, Abram gets the promise, and he doesn't know how God's going to work it all out, but he knows that God is going to do it. He believes him. His faith has grown to the place where he's willing to simply trust God and leave the details to the providence of God. Now, I don't know about you, but this is one of those areas where I always fail too. I trust God, but I think I need to take care of the details. You ever do that? Yeah. Oh, man. Let me tell you something. It is a blessing when God speaks to your heart and says, I will take care of the details. You just be obedient to me and trust me, and I'll take care of all the rest. That's a load off to your hearts. Let me tell you, watch out for trying to take care of the details. Anyway, he's willing to live by faith day by day as the Lord works out his plan and his purpose in his life. By the way, everything God promised to give him, he does give him. He kept his promises to him to the letter. And notice this, that some of the things that he promised Abram are still being worked out today. And God's going to continue to work out his promise to Abram until they are fulfilled. That's where he wants to bring us as well. He wants us to come to a place where we can simply take him at his word and do what he tells us. And we can depend on him to do that, by the way. Now, I want to talk about these seven promises, because in these seven promises, if you study the Word of God at all, you'll find some Bible scholars and these guys who do the commentaries that say that these promises, this Abrahamic covenant, was a specific covenant that applied only to Abraham and his blood offspring. Well, I got news for you today. I studied it, and I'm going to give you the Rick Rubeis version of the Bible, and I believe that every one of those promises that was promised to Abraham is promised to every believer in Jesus Christ. And I'm going to show you that. I'm going to show you that right now. And this is what we're going to celebrate when we come to the communion table. He says to Abram, I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. Now, that's a mouthful, and there's four promises right there. And there are many places we could go in the Word of God to see these verses applying to all believers for all time. But one really covers a multitude of them, and that is what Peter wrote in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. And you've heard me preach from this before and talk to you about it before. Peter is talking to believers in his day, the church in his day, and he says, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God. I will bless you and make your name great, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. That even covers some of the other ones. You see what I'm saying? I'm going to bless you. I'm going to make your name great. Now, talk about making your name great. We can jump all the way over to Revelation chapter 2, verse 17, and see this. He who has an ear, Jesus is speaking himself. Let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes. Now, we know what an overcomer is according to the book of Revelation. It's one who overcame by the blood of the Lamb, the word of the testimony, and they did not think that their lives were more valuable than their testimony, okay? So those who believe in Jesus Christ, I will give some of the hidden manna. Now look, I will also give him a white stone with a new name written on it, known only to him who receives it, I will make your name great. Jesus has a white stone with your name on it. It's an invitation to a great banquet that's going to happen someday in heaven. And what a great and glorious day it's going to be. And your name is going to be great because you're invited to the greatest party that will ever be for all of history, okay? Now also, we see Jesus speaking the same kind of thing in Revelation 3:12. To him who overcomes, I will make a pillar in the temple of my God. In other words, they're going to be unmovable in my house. Never again will he leave it. I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the new Jerusalem, which is coming down from heaven from my God, and I will write on him my new name. Jesus said he's going to make your name great. That's my interpretation. I'm going to take that one to the bank. Just like Abraham's name was made great, your name was going to be made great. Also, he says this, I will bless those who bless you. Jesus in Matthew 10:42 gave it to us this way. As he was speaking to the crowd that day, he said, if anyone gives even a cup of cold water, some kind of refreshment, to one of these little ones, because he is my disciple. Get this. If anyone gives a cup of refreshment to one of my people, that's you, by the way, if you claim him as your personal Savior, I tell you the truth, he will certainly not lose his reward. Rick Rubeis, interpretation, I will bless those who bless you. How about I will curse those who curse you? Paul said it in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 6. God is just. He will pay back trouble to those who trouble you. My interpretation is, I will curse those who curse you. Isn't it great to know that God's got it all handled? We don't even have to hate anybody. We don't have to try to pay him back. God's got it all handled. I will bless those who bless you. I will curse those who curse you. And all the people of the earth will be blessed through you. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 12, Peter said it this way. Believers, live such good lives among the pagans that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us. Believers, live a life so much so in love with me in front of a pagan world that even though they accuse you of doing wrong, they're going to glorify God on the day that he visits us. I will bless all the peoples on earth through you. See, you can be a blessing, just like Abraham was a blessing. Now, it goes even beyond that because Paul tells us in Romans that we are all sons and daughters of Abraham through faith in Jesus Christ. So even though you may not think that your blood runs Jewish, your spiritual blood does because the Bible says that you are all sons and daughters through Abraham. I don't have time to go into all that. Abraham doesn't know how it's all going to work out, but he knows it is. You and I don't know how it's all going to work out, but let me tell you something. According to the Word of God, we have New Testament promises that give us the same promise that Abraham had. Now, as Abraham began his journey of faith, he must have questioned how God can take an old idolater like him and make him a blessing to all the families of the earth. When he died, 100 years later, he died at the age of 175, he still did not have the answer to that question. But I want you to picture this in your mind, if you can. He died in faith. That faith was counted to him as righteousness according to the Word of God. And when Abram died, he went to a place called paradise. Now get this. He waits there some 2,100 years. Then all of a sudden, a man appears in paradise. This man said that his name was Jesus and that he had just died on the cross for the sins of everyone in paradise and for the sins of all who would believe on him. He died for all of those who believed the Word of God and believed his prophets for a Messiah. He died for them. Abraham, in that day in paradise, realized that the last piece of the puzzle has been put in place. This man, Jesus, who descended from Abraham all the way down through Jesus' mother Mary, was the one who would make Abraham a blessing to all nations. Praise God for Jesus. When he left Haran, Abram didn't know how it was going to work out. But he had hope hidden in his heart. His heart yearned for what was coming. He held all the unseen things of the future in the hand of faith. He trusted God to take care of it, and the Lord fulfilled every promise just as he said he would. Now, dear hearts, as you and I live this life of faith in this world, there's going to be times when you and I fail to see the way. There are days when we too will wonder how God will ever work it out, how he's going to use anything like you and I for his kingdom glory. There will be times when we have to walk by faith and not by sight. And dear hearts, some people just refuse to do that. They just cannot do it. If they can't explain it, they avoid it. Those folks never grow. The people God uses greatly are those who walk obediently wherever the path of God leads them, whether they understand it or not, whether they like it or not, whether they know what will happen or not. Those are the people who get to see the Lord part the seas. They're the people who see the multitudes fed. They're the people who get to get out of the boat and walk on the water. They're the ones who walk unharmed through the fiery furnace and through the lion's den of life. They live by faith, and they get to see the Lord do the impossible. Praise his holy name over and over and over again. You know, there's an old saying that goes something like this: the journey of 1,000 miles begins with one step. It took Abram a while, but he made that step, and when he did, he saw God do things that amazed him until the day he died and beyond. I wonder if you made that first step of faith this morning. Have you made a step of faith for salvation? Have you made a step of faith to total surrender? Have you made a step of faith that will take you beyond the humdrum, ordinary run of the mill of life, into the otherworldly realm where God operates and uses people like you and like me for his glory? You and I will never be all that we can be for him until we cut our ties with this world and we cast ourselves on him by faith. I trust that God will help each of us do just that today. We're going to ask the men to come forward and prepare to serve the communion. And as they do, I want to remind you that this is not the communion table of the East Lake Road Alliance Church. This is the communion table of the Lord Jesus Christ. And all who know him as Lord and Savior are invited to come. And even as he said, as many times as we ask to repent and ask for forgiveness, he will do that. Maybe today you're here and you don't know him as Lord and Savior. You've never made that faith commitment. You've never said, Lord, I believe that you died for my sins. I'm sorry for my sins. I repent. I want to live for you from this day forward. You can do that right where you sit. And you can celebrate communion to the Lord Jesus Christ right now today. And if maybe you're here today and you at one time did accept him as Savior, but you really haven't been walking with him as Lord as your life, you got no power in your life, he says to you today, repent, come back to me. The Bible says that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Isn't it great to serve? We serve a God of grace and mercy who continually invites us to come back into a right relationship with him. You can do that today. Just going to ask you to let the Spirit, what you've heard, let the Spirit just examine your heart. Get it right with Jesus and celebrate what we're celebrating today, the Lord's death till he comes. Okay, men, we're going to serve and we're going to ask you to all hold till all have been served and then we'll partake together. We hold in our hand just a broken piece of cracker, signifying the broken body of our Lord Jesus Christ. The holes represent the piercing of his body. The burn represents the scarred body of the Lord Jesus Christ. We believe that Jesus came in the flesh, lived a perfect life, only to have that body bruised, beaten, pierced for our transgressions. We celebrate what Jesus did for us. He paid our sin penalty. Praise his holy name. Shall we partake together? Thank you, Jesus. The Bible tells us on the same night that he was betrayed, the night that he would give his body, he would also spill his blood. The Bible says that without the shedding of blood, there can be no forgiveness of sin. We're going to ask the men to distribute the cup representing the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ and ask you again to hold till all have been served and we'll partake together. Thank you, Lord, for the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. The blood that still has the power to make us whole, to cleanse us from all sin, to heal our body, and to restore our soul. We're going to stand and sing just a couple of verses of this powerful and true hymn, There is Power in the Blood. If you've done any business with God today and you'd like to come and pray at the altar, if you'd like prayer for your body, or you just want to come and pray and ask the Lord to just make you a better Christian, this altar is open. You come as we sing. There is power in the blood. Would you be free?
Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power.
Precious Heavenly Father, how we thank you for the blood of Jesus, the blood that cleanses us from sin, the blood that keeps us day by day in the power of the Spirit. We love you, Lord, for shedding your blood for lost mankind. We thank you that there is still power in the blood, power to save, power to heal, and power to keep. We love you, Lord, and we pray that as you dismiss us, that the love of Jesus would be so real in our lives that people would be drawn to him. Because we have been faithful. We love you, Jesus. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Thank you. Dismissed.